For more on the reaction on Capitol Hill to both the substance and the politics of the president's plan, we're joined by two key members of the Senate's Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee, Ohio Democrat Sherrod Brown and Judd Gregg, Republican of New Hampshire. Let's talk substance first. Gentlemen, thank you for being with us.
Thank you, Judy.
Thank you.
And Senator Brown, to you first, what is there that you like, that you don't like in the president's proposal? What do you make of it?
Well, I think it's still what he's put together is takes us forward significantly. It's, I think, what he's done on everything from the way to pay for this to coverage to tax incentives for small business to provide coverage. The insurance reforms are especially important, that people can stay on their parents' plan, young people till they're 26. All of those are important components of this bill, the prevention, the wellness provisions. There are a number of Republican ideas in this bill. Judd and I sat on the Health Committee last summer when we wrote this bill. We accepted 160 Republican amendments. So there is a Republican flavor to this bill. On some of the big questions, there is philosophical disagreement. But the country clearly voted for change to move forward on this health insurance legislation.
Senator Gregg, the White House is saying this is a starting point. What do you see here that you could work with?
Very little. I mean, it's basically built off of the Senate bill, which was a $2.5 trillion expansion in the size of government. This proposal adds another $200 or $300 billion to that number. And now it introduces a brand new social and industrial engineering exercise, which is that you're going to have price controls over health care insurance, which basically inevitably leads to less insurance being available in the private sector, and you're probably pushing people towards a public sector market, which is something I can't support. There should have been an attempt here to step back and start over again and say, listen, there are things that there are agreement on. There is agreement on between the two parties, and they are fairly substantive, and they could do a lot to make health care better in this country, make delivery system better. Let's start with those items, which we know we have agreement on, rather than build off of a bill which basically was rammed through the Senate Christmas Eve and without any amendments really being allowed at all to speak of once the bill was amended by Senator Reid, and then sent to the House where it can't pass, so they're putting together this bill which is basically trying to buy off constituencies on the left in the House.
Senator Brown, what about Senator Gregg's point that this is essentially a reprise for the most part of what the Senate passed several months ago?
I start with this, Judy, that first of all, it's not been ran through the Senate. This bill has been in the works for months and months and months and months. He's saying on the one hand, it's sort of the same thing as we had. Well, we've been debating this and talking about this, as I said, since May and June when we did our markup. But more than that, this bill doesn't. It pays for itself. It doesn't. It's not this big government takeover that Republicans say. And when I hear my friends like Judd, and I respect Judd and work with him on a couple of committees, I hear him say that we should start over. That's this whole process has been about delay. The negotiations in the Finance Committee, the Gang of Six went on and on and on, when at least two of the three Republicans on the Finance Committee had no interest really in coming to any kind of conclusion that we could all agree on. So the fact is we need to move forward on this. We can continue to, if we start again, it's where's it going to lead to? It's not going to go anywhere, and they know that.
Senator Gregg, I want to ask you about that, but I also want, rather than rehashing everything that happened in the past.
We have been around this track. There's no question about it. A little deja vu all over again.
You're critical of this new federal authority to regulate health insurance rates. Don't the states already do something like this? So what's wrong with the federal government doing something like this?
Well, I think you're essentially setting up a structure which is bound to fail in the sense that if the federal government is going to start stepping in and saying, well, let's take examples where we've had these very significant rate increases, which nobody is very happy about, in various states. And the federal government is going to step in and arbitrarily say, well, you've got to cut that back by 15, 20, 30, 40, 50%. What's the practical event? What's the practical effect of that? You're basically putting in place price controls. And what happens with price controls? Well, that means that the people who are delivering that health care insurance are probably going to make it not be able to make ends meet in their own businesses, so they're going to drop out of coverage of people who presently have health insurance, and you'll have less product available to people. That's inevitable. You'll end up with some level of rationing, and inevitably what you're going to get here is something that I think Sherry probably does agree with, which is a plan where the federal government has to step in and pick up all those people who are forced off of health care because the federal government forced the health insurance companies not to be able to sell the coverage because they couldn't they couldn't make ends meet trying to sell the coverage. So in the end, you end up with a system which is basically pushing us towards a single-payer nationalized system, which is the goal, I believe, of this proposal specifically.
I do want to get Senator Brown to respond, and I apologize because we are having some lighting issues there. We are able to see you, but the light's going up and down. Senator Brown, what about the point that he just made?
Well, I've been working on health insurance issues in the House of Representatives before I was in the Senate for a number of years, and in the most important benefactor to the Republican Party is the insurance industry. And I've seen them always defend insurance industry practices. They did nothing in the years that President Bush had a strong Republican majority in the House and a good majority in the Senate. They did nothing to try to rein in insurance companies. And this is, I don't want to have to deal with insurance companies in this way. I don't want to say to them, you're going to have to cut back. But when they continue to abuse the public interest like this, it's why so many companies are struggling so much because of insurance costs. And the insurance industry clearly has gamed the system. They're always one step ahead of the sheriff. And it's important if we have to make some rules about them and adopt these strong consumer protections, that's what we ought to do.
Well,
Senator
obviously,
Gregg,
the goal here is to have the federal government be the insurer. I mean, that's the goal. I don't think most Americans want that, to be very honest.
Let me ask you, Senator Gregg, are Republicans going to come to the table on Thursday with their own plan or any time between now and then? Because that's what the White House has been asking Republicans to do.
I actually sent a plan down. It was a very comprehensive plan. We call it CPR, and it covers all the elements that the president is concerned about. It gets everybody insured. It reduces the out-year costs of health care, drives down health care costs, lets people keep their insurance if they want to keep it. It uses a market-oriented approach, has a whole series of ideas in it. Sent it down to the White House. I actually did get a call back from Rahm Emanuel, say, well, what does this really mean? I went over it with him. Unfortunately, it got left on the cutting room floor because what they brought forward was just the opposite of what I had suggested, which was a fairly aggressive proposal and not necessarily one that maybe has a majority support on our side of the aisle, but which you could get some Republicans to say, yeah, that makes sense.
So you're saying there are several Republican proposals out there is what you're saying.
Well, there are a couple of very good ones. And in fact, you have a very significant bipartisan one, the Wyden-Bennett one, which had 20 Senate members on it, 10 Democrats, 10 Republicans, which was a very thorough, a comprehensive proposal and used the private markets to generate coverage for every American. And it was a really excellent proposal. And I had reservations about some parts of it, but I thought it was good enough so that I sponsored it. So there are a lot of other starting places than the House and the Senate bills, which passed only with Democratic votes. And really, I know Sherry says there was participation here, but when you get a bill, the guts of a bill on a Saturday afternoon, and you're told you have to vote the next Wednesday, which is Christmas Eve, and there are no amendments allowed between that Saturday and that Wednesday, on the biggest piece of legislation I've ever confronted, that is not the way the Senate's supposed to work.
Senator Brown, what about all the talk we're hearing about the Democrats may be prepared to do this through reconciliation, which shorthand way of saying 51 votes needed only. The White House today didn't rule that out. Do you think the chances are that could happen?
Well, I don't think you do rule that out. I mean, the Republicans rammed through tax cuts for the wealthy three different times using reconciliation. We're the only Democratic country, I think, in the world that requires a supermajority that Republicans have forced us to do basically everything under this supermajority. And a majority of people making a decision in a legislative body is hardly anti-democratic with a small D. So if Republicans continue to block and continue to filibuster, they've done it over 100 times, breaking all records, then we need to do what we need to do to pass a good health care legislation.
If that happens,
Judy, one more thing. 390 people every day in my state lose their insurance. And the more we delay, the more people are hurting. And I'm tired of this kind of obstructionist tactic that we've seen over and over again.
Well, it's not obstructionism to try to get this thing right. And a lot more people in your state, Sherry, are going to lose their insurance if you start arbitrarily fixing prices on insurance, because you're going to drive people out of their capacity to buy insurance because your insurers will not be available. Well, no, you don't. I accept your point, which is we should go to a single-payer system, but I don't agree with it. I don't think it gives you the best health care.
You're the one that keeps saying we're advocating for a single-payer system. Most Democrats aren't. Most Democrats want to see people covered.
There are some strong views.
All right.
There are just a few. But hopefully we can have an open debate on the floor of the Senate and have amendments and let the
Gentlemen,
Senate work as well.
We appreciate
Thanks.
Your airing your views with us today. Senator
Thank
Gregg,
you,
Senator Brown, thank
Thanks.
You both.
Thanks.